With our words and in our actions,
let us praise the living God.
With our lips and in our lives,
let us glorify the Lord.
Praise and confession. Holy God, who calls the worlds into being, who calls us into Christ's church, we thank you for the church that is our true home, for the mission of the church that is our true joy, for the ministry of the church that is our proper task. We thank you for the ministry of this denomination, for its faithful witness in the struggle for justice and peace, for its example in caring ways. We thank you for the ministry of the church in this place, for pastors and people who over time have praised your name and served your way. We thank you for the gifts of scripture and prayer, strong paths by which your spirit flows into the church. In our reading, in our praying, we yield ourselves to you. Open our senses to discern your will for us now. Refocus our mission and ready our gifts for ministry in the community and in the world. Gracious God, move us beyond ourselves. beyond any excuses, any resentments, any single-minded ways. Merciful God, forgive, renew, and guide us, that we may become a resounding song of praise with all of the glory going to you. We pray in the name of Jesus crucified, the Lord of the church. Amen. My friends, hear this good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In that promise, the power is the power to love your neighbor and yourselves, the courage to be a community united in faith, hope, and love. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, starting at verse 1. Listen for the word of the Lord. Now, even the first covenant had regulations for worship and an earthly sanctuary. For a tent was constructed, the first one, in which were the lampstand, the table, and the bread of presence. This is called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a tent called the Holy of Holies. In it stood the golden altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant overlaid on all sides with gold, in which there were a golden urn holding the manna and Aaron's rod that budded and the tablets of the covenant. Above it were the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat. Of these things we cannot speak now in detail. Such preparations having been made, the priests go continually into the first tent to carry out their ritual duties. But only the high priest goes into the second, and he but once a year, and not without taking the blood that he offers for himself and for the sins committed unintentionally by the people. But when Christ came as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and perfect tent, not made with hands, that is not of this creation, he entered once for all into the holy place, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls with a sprinkling of ashes of a heifer sanctifies those who have been defiled so that their flesh is purified, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to worship the living God? This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Worship is definitely one of the highlights of the work that I get to do. I look forward to being lost in wonder, love, and praise. Now, I do have opinions and preferences, early or earlier, traditional or more contemporary music, pews or chairs. But for many of our spiritual ancestors, choice and preference in worship would be a foreign concept. The first part of our passage this morning reminds us that God had very specific requirements for the tabernacle used by the people of Israel while under the leadership of Moses. Unlike the process of building a custom house when you make a million decisions, and after that first million, the builder comes back with another batch of questions. God made it easy for Moses and the people. There were no decisions to make, just instructions to follow. From the layout to the furnishings, even the recipe for the incense. We get a recap of this in Hebrews, a glimpse of what it might be like to enter the Holy of Holies, a place that only the high priest was allowed to enter. You know, I always wondered why. Why was there so much attention to detail about exactly what would go where and how it was arranged and who could go in and when? Thing is, God had been a distant God for the most part. Moses would experience God's presence, but only by going up on the mountain alone, and then he would bring back word from God. The tabernacle marked a change. God was preparing a way to be among the people, right there in the middle of camp. And because people are physical, embodied beings, not just spiritual beings, God provides for sensory means of experiencing God's presence. All those sights and smells and sounds and textures, they're meant to connect humankind to the beauty and grandeur of this being that is completely other, God. Worship wasn't some casual or accidental meetup that happened as God was passing by. With this tabernacle, God was designing a place of rendezvous with wonder and awe. And then he called the people to come in. But the writer of Hebrews doesn't leave us in the tabernacle. He reminds us of another step, a really big step in God's relationship with humankind. Jesus, the Messiah, is Emmanuel, God with us. And unlike a human high priest, Jesus doesn't broker forgiveness by taking an animal sacrifice into the Holy of Holies. Jesus took on the role of mediator by taking on flesh and blood. And as John's Gospel tells us, by tabernacling among us. His very life bridged the gap between creator and created, between God and humankind. The new covenant in Christ's blood allows us to worship God, who is nearer than ever before, dwelling within us, empowering us in the person of the Holy Spirit. That worship, that connection between humankind and God has taken on many forms between the days of Peter and Paul and our own pandemic times. I can't think of a time more suited than this, in fact, to take on this question. What does it mean for the church to continue to commit to the maintenance of divine worship? The familiar story of Jesus overturning tables and clearing out the temple is a great reminder of just how easily we humans can be distracted from worship by side issues. We don't sell overpriced pigeons or blemished sacrificial lambs in the narthex. But oh, the conflicts I have seen when we sing too many hymns in one month that we don't know. Or someone reads from the wrong translation of Psalm 23. And then there are the dangers of choosing a new carpet color, switching to gluten-free bread for communion, or letting the choir take a break from those hot robes for how long? And then we get to these pandemic times. Do we gather inside or not? Do we mask or not? Do we sing together or not? Here's the thing. Every time how a congregation worships becomes a greater focus than who they are worshiping, I start watching and waiting for angry Jesus to come in and flip the communion table to get everybody's attention. From the very beginning, followers of Jesus have felt it, this tension between the desire to maintain tradition and the need to adapt as people and their communities and their needs change. Which leads me to an important question. If the church is responsible for the preservation of divine worship, and the context in which we worship occur changes regularly, how do we know what to preserve? Well, our Presbyterian tradition points us to four essential elements of worship: book, bath, meal, and service. Okay, book. That's the book. Word, right? The word. And the interpretation of scripture, which is actually more than a reading or two followed by a sermon. Hymns and anthems and prayers and liturgical readings, they often include and then go on to expand on those scriptures. Most Presbyterians I know expect a good chewy sermon. These acts of proclamation provide a living, active sense of the connection between worship and our daily lives in the world in light of what we've received from God's word. Okay, so word. Then bath, baptism. Sadly, baptism doesn't happen every week. I say it's sad because when we baptize a child or an adult, we're welcoming a new member into the family. We're celebrating God's new creation, new life. But I still like having the font front and center as a reminder. A reminder that we have been baptized in water and in spirit as a person, each of us, and as a community of faith. Every time I walk by it to set up for worship and I see it, it reminds me I am a beloved child of God. And I pray that seeing the font is a reminder that you are too. That you are children of God, created and claimed in love, washed clean, forgiven, and wrapped up in the grace and mercy of God in Christ Jesus. All right, so book, bath, table. The joyous feast that we celebrate at the table is open to all who have been baptized and follow Jesus. That same meal has been central to worship since the very earliest days of the church. The settings and the rituals have changed over time, but the words of institution were preserved with the writings of the Apostle Paul, who heard the story of the Last Supper from probably one of the 12 who were right there on the night that our Lord was betrayed. Whether we share that meal here in the sanctuary or separately in our homes, we bless and we break apart the bread, and we bless and we portion out the juice or wine. And as each one partakes of our share, the body that can feel like so many, many, many separate pieces is brought back together. Each member is made part of the whole, remembered, as we remember the one who broke down the wall and who draws all people near. We're connected by the table that has been extended, sharing one spiritual loaf, one cup of salvation, giving honor and thanks for one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in all. All right, so book, bath, meal. Service is the fourth. Not worship service, like the order of worship that we follow, but service to others. Once again, our faith tradition is what reminds us that like Abraham and Sarah, we are blessed to be a blessing. We are reminded that the faith, hope, and love that we experience in the book, Bath and Meal, are of very little value if the community fails to bear witness to that grace beyond the walls of the sanctuary. In his gospel, Matthew recounts a moment when Jesus looks out at the crowds gathered, and Jesus had compassion on them because he said they were like sheep without a shepherd, harassed, helpless. He taught that day, but Jesus also turned and told his disciples to pray, a specific prayer, that the Lord would send more laborers. Jesus looked at all those people, and he looked at the men and women who would be the beginnings of a new way of following God's law, and he knew they were going to need a lot more hands and feet. They needed to pray for some more people, maybe some of those who were in that crowd that very day, to become disciples. And they needed to pray that those new disciples would be able to teach and prepare still more, so that the good news would be proclaimed, so that still more believers would be baptized. Jesus wanted his closest followers to continue helping and healing and reconciling and feeding and comforting those who were destitute, weary, grieving, or ill, all of which requires us to see people as Jesus did, with compassion. It's easy to think of our witness to others through acts of compassion as something totally separate from worship, another task. After all, it falls in another committee, right? Mission? The reality is that anytime we point to God, anytime the focus shifts away from the things that we want, even the things we need in that moment, to the support and the care of the least of these, we are pointing beyond ourselves to God. We are declaring the good news of Christ, that the world doesn't have to be this way. And we are drawing on the power of the Holy Spirit to make it so. In other words, our whole lives can be worship. Our whole lives are worship. So amazing that we lose ourselves in it. Lost in the wonder of service. Lost in the love for God's children. Lost in praise and thanksgiving for each new day. And it is when we are lost like that, that we find our truest selves. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
How wonderful it is that God inclines his ear to hear our prayers. Let us go to God in prayer for the community and the world in a responsive prayer. Gracious God, as your church, as your community of faith, hope, and love, help us to be witnesses for you. Loving the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. May we abandon our need of entertainment with this profound awareness. Our worship is for you. May we share our God-given gifts of creativity, water, bread, and wine in gratitude and praise to you. And may the table at which we gather never run out of room for one more. We pray for the mission of the church to let your glory shine. May we faithfully struggle to understand truth, so that instead of being bound and imprisoned by it, we might see that it joyfully and completely sets us free. May we seek the mind of Christ and honor what is right. We pray for the mission of the church to keep your truth and light. May we be a safe place for everyone to question, to know, to struggle, and to grow. May we reach out to the lost and lift up those who fall. We pray for the mission of the church to show your love for all. May each and everything that undermines God's love make us so uncomfortable we cannot help but act. May we serve the common good and live what we confess. We pray for the mission of the church to seek your righteousness. May we seek to be the presence of Christ in the world without creating clubs that push people away, telling the world what we have seen and heard. Let us pray for the mission of the church to speak your saving word. May we live as we believe, shining light into darkness, sprinkling salt into bland ways, and celebrating joyful life together. May we watch and work and pray until Christ comes again. Let us pray for the mission of the church to share your holy reign. And now we pray together the prayer that you taught your disciples, dear Lord, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Worship. You were made to glorify God. Whether we are gathered together in great big groups as two or three, whether we are around a table that extends to homes or back in this beautiful space, our worship is true when the Spirit is with us. And so, as you go about your day, remember that you have been claimed so that you might proclaim. You have been fed so that you might serve. In the power of the Holy Spirit and the peace of Christ, go worship your Lord. Amen.